Hi everyone. My name is Farzad and today I'm going to talk about the fundamentals of fuzzy networks. Fuzzy networks was first introduced by Alex Gigov and I'm sure he will join us at the end of this presentation to answer your questions. Both Alex and I work at University of Portsmouth. The outline of the presentation for today, after a short introduction about the fuzzy system and different types of that, I'm going to talk about the formal models for fuzzy networks, basic operations, and the proper structural properties of the basic operations, advanced operations for fuzzy network as well. And also I'm going to talk about the network design, feed forward and feedback fuzzy networks. Then how to evaluate and the indicators to evaluate the performance of the fuzzy networks. It goes with some case studies, two case studies I'm going to explain, and how to use a fuzzy network, and at the end, some conclusion with some references. So you're talking about the modeling. For complex system modeling, we have four main issues. One of them is nonlinearity, because in most of the data modeling that we have, we are facing with nonlinearity. We cannot actually easily linearly model our data. Uncertainty, which comes with the incompleteness and noise of the data, dimensionality, which talks about the large number of the inputs and the features and also output, as well as the structure, the interacting subsystem, how inside the model, how the variables work and influence each other. So this is the main problem with a complex system. But fuzzy system is a very powerful tool to answer that and to be used for modeling complex systems. How? Feasibility. The model feasibility is achievable in case of nonlinearity. We can easily model nonlinear data with fuzzy system. Accuracy. Fuzzy system has shown in the literature that they do very well with uncertainty and accuracy of our model. Efficiency, which is a bit problematic at the moment when the number of the inputs increases, and also the transparency. This is problematic area because it's in terms of interpretability of the model, how to interpret the model and the structure of the model in terms of the white and black box. The transparency is one of the problems that we have with complexity. So fuzzy system trying to address all of them. Fuzzy network try to address all of them, and I'm going to talk about that. Different type of fuzzy system from different perspective. One of them is about the antecedents and the rules. We have disjunctive antecedents and conjunctive rules, and all the permutation of that. Disjunctive and conjunctive antecedents comes with disjunctive and conjunctive rules. We have different type of models that can be discussed. Because of interest of time, and I'm sure that there are plenty of literature about that, so I pause that. But this is one of the type of the fuzzy system models that we need to think. Input-output, we have from single input to multiple output. Single input, single output, single input, multiple output. So we have different type of a structure for the model in terms of how many inputs we have and how many outputs. And we can define different type of fuzzy systems. Rule-based systems, very famous now, but different properties. We talk about the completeness in terms of the rule, consistency, again about the rules, exhaustiveness and monotonicity. So these are features for the properties of the, again, rule-based system, but it's not the focus of my presentation today. When it comes to the different type of rule-based system, this is the area that we want to address today, more or less. We have three main rule-based systems. One of them is single rule-based systems, or the most important one is standard or called standard fuzzy system, that we have a black box. I will show you in the next slide. We have a black box. We have number of inputs and number of the outputs. We don't know what happens there. One time of fuzzification, inference and defuzzification actually take place there. And it's quite conventional and very old type of fuzzy systems. The other one is hierarchical fuzzy system that we have different rule bases that rule based modular systems that all that, and the next one is interacting rule based system, rule bases, that this is the new generation of the fuzzy system, which is called network fuzzy systems, and the focus of this presentation. So in terms of the single rule standard fuzzy system, we have, as I said, we have number of inputs and output, and all the fuzzification, inference and defuzzification will take place here. In terms of the accuracy, it's really good because actually we do the modeling only once and the error term will go down. But in terms of the transparency and structure is not good, because when the numbers go up, we've got to look at all the permutation of the actually inputs and the linguistic variables, and it makes it so difficult. So in terms of the transparency, it's very weak. The other one is hierarchical fuzzy system, or multiple rule bases, or chain rule bases. As you see here, we've got some rule bases. Each of them has got some inputs, and for example, we've got X3 for the other one. So we've got to run fuzzification perform one fuzzification, inference, and defuzzification, and then the output will be act as an input for the next rule based system, and then it, actually we fit the input and output from left to right to actually get the output of the model, which is Y. So as you see, in terms of the transparency, it's really good because we can understand what happens inside the model, and we can monitor, we can control the modeling process. But the problem is with the accuracy, because each time when we run this fuzzification, inference and defuzzification, we come up with some errors. So our output actually contains some errors. So these errors accumulatively actually go forward, and when it comes to the void, then the accuracy and the actually error term in the model increases, which is not something that we want. And as you see, for example, input can go to the last rule basis in terms of actually the way that we structure the model. The next one, which is the fuzzy network, the one that is our main focus today, is about a hybrid approach between fuzzy system and standard fuzzy system and hierarchical fuzzy system. It means I want to get the advantage of both of those two systems and introduce new one. In terms of a structure, as you see, it's a network, because in the previous one, as you see, for example, X3 goes to this one, but here, sorry, here we introduce a new modular basis. We call it identity node. Each of them is node. And we try to put them nicely in terms of the structured network in layers and levels. I will explain that. So in terms of the structure, it's similar to hierarchical fuzzy system. But in terms of performance, by finding an equivalent composition of these nodes, these rule-based system, we try to come up with the big equivalent matrix for this fuzzy system, and use only one fuzzification, inference, and defuzzification to increase the accuracy of that. So as you see, from the structure point of view, it's quite similar to the hierarchical fuzzy system. In terms of the accuracy and performance, it's quite close to the fuzzy system. So it tried to get both advantage of these two. So my job today is to tell you how, if you come up with such a model, and if you want to model it, how to compose and compress these nodes together and make a big fuzzy system, a standard fuzzy system, let's say something similar to that, and do your modeling. So this is our job for today. So formal models for fuzzy networks. So how we can show fuzzy networks. So one of them is conventional way of that, for example, with if then rules, if X is slow, and Y is, then Y is small. So average, high, small, medium, and big. When it comes to the integer table, we can actually represent low by one, average by two, and high by three. In that case, we can say when X is one, Y is one. X is two, Y is two, X is three, Y is three. We call it modeling using integer table. This is not something that we want to use in the fuzzy network. The one that we are actually interested to use in fuzzy network is using Boolean matrices and Boolean algebra, because it helps us to actually make it, actually compress this model and this network and make a fuzzy network. So in that case, we say if the input is low and if this output is y is one, small, so dependence is 1, 1, it gets value for 1. But if, for example, we don't have such a rule, if 1 is low and y is medium. So because we don't have such a rule, so they get 0 values. So as you see here, 1 and 1, 2 and 2, and 3 and 3, they get value of 1, 1, 1 for each. We chose the rule basis that we have here. We have another way of showing that it's a binary relationship, that relations that you see 1, 1, 2, 2, and 3, 3. But we are mainly, actually the focus of our job here is based on these Boolean matrices. Grid structure. So each network has got some levels and layers. The levels are the rows, the layers are the columns. The interconnection structure is that when we have Y, and we can show that, for example, from node 1 to node 2, we have the Y as an output, but we can show as an N1 one, it means that the layer 1, level 1, layer 1, and the input is X, and the output is 1. So this is a good way of showing that. Another one is to use block schemes, that we have a node block, 1, 1, level 1, layer 1, input X, and output is 1. And topological expression that I'm going to use more or less this is that we have the node here, and this is the input, and this is the output. So the mainly I will use this expression for and to talk about that. So there are a couple of operations for fuzzy network to be able to find an equivalent, actually a rule base for the whole network, and how to actually put them, merge them vertically, horizontally, put them all together and come up with the one matrix for fuzzy system and try to use that for the model. I start with, as you see here, horizontal merging of nodes. So horizontally, it means that we want to, when you have N11, N12, they are in the same level, but in the different layer, we want to be able to merge them. As you see, X11 is an input to that node. This is the output of that node, which acts as an input for the next node, and this is the output. Horizontal merging is the operation that can be applied when the output from the first node is fed forward as an input to the second node in form of an intermediate variable, as you see here. When a Boolean matrix is used as a formal model for the operand node, the horizontal merging operation is identical with the Boolean matrix multiplication. So multiplication takes here, takes place here. So as this is the symbol for horizontal merging, this is the node 1, input, output, node 2, 1, 2 actually, first level, second layer, and this is the input and output. We want to merge them together. So we use multiplication for that, and it's quite similar to the matrix multiplication when the arithmetic multiplication is replaced by a minimum operation, and each arithmetic addition is replaced by a maximum operation. I'll show you an actual example to see how it works. So if this is our first rule base, and here, for example, this is the rule base for this one, modular rule base. 1, 1, 2, actually 2, 3, and 3, 2. So these are our actually linguistic variables and the rules. And this is N12. 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, and 3, 1. When we want to actually merge them horizontally, as I said, it's a Boolean multiplication. And what we get, we call it N11*1, 2. It's a horizontal merging. So for example, here 1, the output is 1. So 1 is the 1 is the input for the second one, the output is 2. So if you want to merge them, the input is 1, the output is 2. So because of that, 1 and 2 is actually the merging of these two rules. For example, 2 is 3 and 3 is 1. So 2 is 1. 2 is 1. And here 3, 2, 2, 3, so 3, 3. There you go. So this is the way that we actually merge them horizontally to nodes using a multiplication of the Boolean algebra. The next one is a horizontal splitting of the nodes. When you want to split the nodes, opposite, we want to split them, we merge them horizontally merge them, now we want to split the nodes horizontally. This is the symbol that we use for them, and as you see, 1, 1, 1, we want to split it with 1, 2, this is the way that we do the operation. A horizontal splitting is the operation of splitting an operand node into a pair of sequential product nodes, whereby the input to the first node, let me see, the input to the first node is the same as the input to the operand node, and the output from the second product node is the same as the output from the operand node. When a Boolean matrix is used as a formal model for the operand node, the horizontal splitting operation is identical with Boolean matrix factorization. So factorization in Boolean algebra comes to help to be able to split them. But again, I'll show you how it works. This is the node, I want to see how it works. So 1, 1 is 1. So when the input is 1, this is 2, this one should be 1 to be able to get that. So in that case, we can split the nodes using the factorization. It means that it's the opposite of merging of them. So we've got to look at the same inputs and the same inputs and the same output and be able to actually split them. The next operation is vertical merging. So we have two nodes, as you see here, for example, N11 and N21. They are in different levels, but in the same layer. And each of them has got their own input and their output. What we want to do, we want to merge them. We want to put them together and make a bigger rule base, but have one, not to have separate fuzzy in the hierarchical one, fuzzification, inference and defuzzification, and so this, the other one, to perform that again for the other node, but we want to merge them and then, for example, do the operation, perform the fuzzification, inference and defuzzification. So what we do here, as you see, this is the sign, plus, first node, second node, we want to add them, merge them vertically. So this is the sign for that, this is the input, and this is the output. So just a little bit more about that, because this is very important operation for the fuzzy network. The operation merges the operand nodes from the pair into a single product node. In case the inputs here, the product nodes represent the union of the inputs to the operand nodes, whereas the outputs from the product node represent the union of the outputs from the operand nodes. When Boolean matrices are used as formal models for the operand nodes, the vertical merging operation is like an expansion of the first operand matrix along its rows and columns. I'll show you how it works. Look, we've got N11, N21, we want to merge them. So what happens is that because we've got to merge them, it means that we have two inputs. We've got to go for all the permutation of them. So what happens? We've got all the permutation. So as you see, for the first one, we can get the location of this one. And because we have actually two inputs, each of them three, so it means that we've got 9 inputs permutation for the X, same for the Y. So we have all of them based on this position 1, 1, 1, we've got these three blocks, and for each block we can replace this one. So in that case, as you see, we replace them here and we come up with the big matrix like that. Vertical splitting nodes, it's opposite again. When we want to split them in the opposite direction, so similar to this, when we have that, we know that it's a composition of two matrices, so we know the locations are here, 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is our first matrix, first actually modular base, and each of them has got this 1, 1, 1, actually 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, and 0, 1, 1. So as you see here, we've got the same thing. So this is the opposite of that, and we can actually decompose in vertically and split them in this way. Merging, this is very important, output merging. So it means that when you have two nodes, they've got in the different layers, they've got different, they've got same inputs, but they've got different outputs. How we can actually merge these two together? It means that we are merging the output nodes. So this is the sign, as you see. And how it works. The operation merges operand nodes from the pair into a single product node. In this case, the inputs to the product node are the same as the common inputs to operand nodes, whereas the outputs from the product node represents the union of the outputs from the operand node. So we are talking about the union here. So what happens? This is the first matrix, this is the second matrix. As you see, the inputs are the same, so the inputs are the same, but this is different. So as you see here, we look at that. Here, we've got 1, 1, 1. Actually, you can, on the paper, you can easily work out how it works. It's quite logical. For example, I'll show you here. This is one, and this one gives you two. It means that 1, 1 should give you 1, 2. So 1, 2 gets value for one. But in a quick way, so what happens is that we know that we have three inputs and all the permutations, we've got actually 9 columns here. So in the block of 3, we can see them. So the positions of the one actually comes here, as you see here, these are the positions for the ones. And in each, actually these values are replaced, as you see. Using this very simple technique, we can actually merge them, merge the output. In the same way, but in the opposite, when we want to split them. So this is the sign symbol that we use for output splitting. We want to split the output and put in different actually nodes. What we do, as you see, same inputs, we've got all the permutation for the outputs. What you've got to do only, this gives you the positions of the ones for the first matrix, as you see here. And and the values of these three, as you see, 3, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, gives you the second matrix for this output merge. So we discussed output merging as well. Let's look at the structural properties of these basic operations. These basic operations are quite important. We built the fuzzy network based on these very simple operations. Associativity of horizontal merging. So it means that if you have more than one nodes that you want to add. So for example, if you want to horizontally merging them, what you do, first of all, first merge first two together. For example, here, first merge these two. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2. It means that this is the output from the first one as an input to the second one. This is the input. This is the input and this is the output. So as you see, if you want to merge these two, merge these three together, first of all, merge these two together or merge these two together and then merge them together. So this is the input and this is the output. But this is the notation that we use to merge them horizontally, these three nodes. So the same story that if you want to actually use numerical or using Boolean matrices, the same techniques that I told you, it could be a good practice actually, you can watch it and do it yourself. So this is the first node, this is the, they are in the same level. First level, second layer, and this is the last one. And if you want to merge them, actually it's quite easy. The one gives you one, one gives you two, two, gives you two. So it means that one gives you two. So the same story that we had before, we can actually horizontally merge them. To interest of time, I'll try to speed up here a little bit because they're quite close to the start, similar to what I explained in the main four operations of, four or five operations of fuzzy network. Variability of the horizontal splitting, if you want to split them, for example, these three, so first of all, you can split the first one and then these two together, and at the end, you come up with splitting all of them, so two of them, and then the next one. So if this is your, for example, the node that you want to split, similar to what we said before, you can split them and get these two matrices in terms of the horizontally, the opposite direction that we did for merging. Associativity of vertical merging. So vertical merging, we want to merge them in this format. Again, similar to what we did before, first of all, merge two of them and then merge with the next one. If this is BO3 actually nodes, this is the first one, second, and the third, as they are in different levels. So the first one gives you the location of the ones. This is the location of the ones, as you see here, three blocks here. Look, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. You may ask me why we have this number of the rows, because we have three inputs. We have each input has got three linguistic variables. So we have 27 combination of the actually inputs. And because of that, each of them shows three rows, so 27. So this each block shows, so the easy way is that this shows the blocks for ones. Actually, this shows the blocks. This shows the inside the matrix. Sorry. So these are this shows the block. This is the second one, and each one in the here, each one here is replaced by the values here. So because of that, you see I3 is the anti-diagonal, because that's anti-diagonal matrix. So what happens is that this comes, the location of the blocks is comes from the first matrix, the first one, and we get the format of these ones from the second one, second matrix, and each one is coming out of the third matrix, the anti-diagonal. So the same story that I said for the next one. And the variability of the vertical splitting, again, if you have that, this gives you the position of the ones. So we can easily say that the first one is, the first matrix is 1, 1, 1, the rest 0, 1, 1, the rest 0. Each one is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 in this way, like a tick. There you go, this is the second one. And third one, here is actually anti-diagonal. This is the matrix that we have for the third one. So quite similar to what I did for the simple two splitting or merging the matrices. So associativity of the output merging, again, if we have three nodes and we want to merge the outputs, then they have the same inputs. We've got to 2 by 2 to do them and actually first two together and then merge it with the next one. If this is, for example, so as you see here, we have first node, second node, and this is the third node, and I want to merge them. The way that I do is that I know that I have three inputs only, three linguistic variables, actually for that 1, 2, and 3, but I have permutation of all the outputs. So because of that, I have 27, this A, B, C, D, F, each of them shows three inputs. As you see, I think we've got it here. Yes, A, for example, is 1, 1, 1 till 1, 1, 3. In terms of that, what happens is that again, the first one gives us the position of them. So here, we've got 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Here, 1, 1, 1 gives us the position here, 1 in these three blocks. It's quite logical, you know, as I said, using union, using multiplication of Boolean matrices, all of them are quite logical and can be done, but I'll try to summarize in a way that you can actually quickly get that. So these three is coming from the first one, and actually each of them gets a row of the second one, if I'm right. Where is that? Yes, this one, and this one. Look, one is here. When it comes here, one is here. And each of them gets the right row from this, as you see, I1, I2, and I3, and they sits here in terms of these. So this is the way that actually we can, because of interest of time, I'll try to actually be quicker. The split of that is the opposite way, and I skip that because I don't have time, and go to augmentation. For augmentation, it's an advanced operation of the fuzzy system. Node transformation is usually applied to for input augmentation when two or more nodes in particular layers of a fuzzy network have some common inputs as well as inputs that are not common to all these nodes. In this case, it is necessary to augment the nodes with the missing common inputs such that all the nodes have only common inputs. The purpose of this augmentation is to allow the output merging operation and this its property of associativity of to be applied to all nodes in the first layer of the fuzzy net. It means that when we have common inputs, and if you for in terms of the merging them, you need to actually have the more permutation of them. We augment the matrix. What we do, we repeat them. As you see, for example, this is the matrix. We actually find the permutation of them, as you see, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, and all of them, and repeat the values for them. And in that case, we have augmented matrix for them, and we can use that when we have common inputs. So output permutation, or OP, as you see, or PO, NPO, when we want to permute the output. What we do, actually, we permute the output, for example, here. And when we use that, when we have cross path for the inputs, when we have cross, for example, one input from one node goes up and the other one goes down, and we want to put them in the right direction in the actually parallel ways in terms of input and output, sometimes we've got to actually get rid of this cross path and use and change the permute the output to be able to do that. So what happens is that if this is our node N and it comes out of Y1 and Y2, we want to change it to Y2 and Y1. As I said, we want to actually switch them or get rid of this cross path. So what we do, we easily actually change the values. I mean that, for example, 1 is 2, 3, so 1 will be 3, 2. 2 is 3, 1, 2 will be 1, 3. And here 3 is 1, 2. When you find the NPO, the output permutation actually will be 2, 1. So next one, which is very important, is a node transformation and feedback equivalent. In modeling, sometimes the output of the node acts as an input to its node again. In terms of the control modeling, we have a lot of cases like that. But what we've got to do, we've got to get rid of this loop. What we do, we say that it depends on the position of them, where actually this loop is, we've got to make the right decision for that. So for example, here it's X, Z, Y, and Z. Input is X and Z, Y is Y and Z, but Z is at the bottom, actually input and output, we've got to get rid of that, get rid of this loop or feedback. So how we can do that? In this case, as you see, we can get rid of this loop, and each of them would be the X equivalent of feedback, Y equivalent of feedback, and this is the new nodes for that, because that doesn't do anything for this. So what happens is that this one is 1 for the 1s, it gets 1. When this is 2 for the 2s, it gets 1. When this is 1 for the 1s, it gets 1. This is 2 for the 2s, it gets 1. As you see, for the 2s, it gets 1. So this is the way that we can get rid of this feedback and replace that by this equivalent feedback notation and the Boolean matrix. In that case, we can solve the problem. Node identification, let me check the time, 34 minutes. I'll try to wrap it up in 10, 15 more minutes to just cover some more modeling stuff. So node identification in the horizontal merging. So in the horizontal merging, when we don't have one of the matrices or the Boolean matrices. So for example, we have AUC, A horizontal merging and C, we have A and C, but we don't have U. So that's quite good because A gives, if you want to find U, but look, you've got to write the Boolean equation and solve the simultaneous equation to be able to solve that. But I'm going to show you how it works. But generally speaking, again, it works based on Boolean algebra, and using the Boolean algebra techniques for solving simultaneous equation, you can solve that. More information is available in Alex's book, in details of how actually you can use the Boolean, simultaneous equation to solve them. But imagine that this is A and this is C. As I said, you write this Boolean simultaneous equation, you can solve U in this way. I can pause that. So U, B, C, again, if you know B and if you have C, if you want to find B, again, you can actually go back to this pattern as well to be able to find them, but using the simultaneous equation you can find. But this is not a unique matrices. You may come up with different formation and different form of the Boolean matrices for those unknown matrix that we have. Again, if you have, for example, A, U, B, C, and we have A, B, C, and how to find that. So first of all, you can actually, what to do, you can say that A, U is D, and then D, horizontal merging B, C, and then try to find the unknown, non-unique unknown. So again, writing those matrices will help you to find that. Sorry. Node identification in vertical merging. Now, if we want to have, we want to merge them vertically, but we have unknown, we don't know. For example, we have the equivalent of the rule-based system, but we don't know one of them, and we've got to find that. These techniques can help you, but again, you can refer to the Alex book and the joint publications, Alex and I, so actually you can read more about that, but just quickly over that. A, C, as you see, this is A, and this is C. Again, this is the, these are the position that you can get from the first matrix, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and this is the second one. This is the second matrix, as you see. So this is repeated here. So this is the way that you can find the unknown, but if you have U plus B equals C, U gives you the location, B is the, matrices, as you see, the 1, 1, 1 is the location which the first matrix that we have. So U is 1, 1, 1, as you see, the location 1, 1, and 1. So again, if you have more of them, so you can combine two of them together and then find the next one. And node identification output merging. So if you want to output merging, as you remember in output merging, we have the same input. So you have A and you have Y, and we have C, which is the big matrix as you hear, but we have three of them, as is the location of them is quite important. This is the first matrix, as you see, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. In actually value of three values for them, 1, 1, 1. And so this is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and 0, 1, 0 will be the matrix of unknown. Exactly similar to what I discussed before. So you can actually use that here. Again, if you have B here, second one, and C, what should be done? Again, this is the first one, the location of the first one, 1, 1, 1. This is the U. This is something that you are looking for. For more than that, we can actually, 2 by 2, we can merge them together and actually find the unknown. Feed forward, this is more or less about the network design. I think this is quite important and we can have a better understanding using the technique that I explained. So if you have only one node, so this is a standard fuzzy system, network with a single level and single layer. So this is a standard fuzzy system. It's not a network, so this is the notation and you can easily find the equivalent. But when it comes to more complicated, when we have network with single level and multiple layers, single level, multiple layers. So example one, network analysis. So this is the notation of this one. As you see, we have one input, two nodes here, but we have this cross path. as I said, output permutation will help definitely here. And this is the output. How we can solve this problem? First of all, you've got to get rid of this cross path. What we do is we use output permutation, as I said, by changing the permutation of the output. In that case, we can actually put them in the right place. When you do that, then you've got to merge them horizontally. As you see, this is merge them horizontally. So instead of this complex, not complex, but instead of this network, we can actually merge them and find the equivalent fuzzy network. This is something that we are looking at. So as you see, we've got to merge them, but before that, we've got to, first of all, we've got to use permutation for the output to do that, and then horizontally merge them, X1, Y1, and all of them, as you see, they should be similar, they should be the same, because the input of this one is the output of, so the output of this is the input of this second one. So because of that, we see only X11 and Y11. So this is the example one. The algorithm for that is defined NE, the equivalent, and N12. So this is the first one. That's, this is the way that we did. Derive that this one, if possible, find N11, inverse output permutation of this one. Algorithm 1-2 is defined NE, which is the output permutation, and N11, find this by output permutation of this, and the one, and derive N12 if possible. So this is the way that we can design that network that I explained on those graphs. Let me check the time. Not bad. So if you have network with multiple levels and single layer, multiple levels, and one layer. This is the one. So as you see here, we've got two nodes, common inputs for them, and we've got this input for this node only, we've got two outputs. As you, if you remember, I said that if we don't have common inputs, we to have some common inputs, we've got to, because to be able to merge them, the number of the inputs should be the same to be able to merge them. One of them cannot be more than the other one. So what we've got to do, we've got to make them the same size. So we've got to augment the matrix. So as you see, immediately we can augment this matrix, augmented one, N21 is augmented, X112 is augmented of that. When you augment them, then you can actually merge them. As you see, then you can vertically merge them. Output merging, we've got to do output merging because there are two nodes, same inputs. So we've got to merge the output. So by output merging, we can actually find the equivalent. As you see, we augment the second one and then output merging for this. As you see, output merging of N11, N21 augmented. These are the inputs. We have two inputs and we have two outputs. This is the form for that. The network design defined NE and N21. The augmented matrix by input augmentation of this one and derive N11 if possible. This is another algorithm, define NE and N11, NE is and actually equivalent of compositional equivalent matrix, and then we can drive the next one for network design. Example three, if you have that, I would be a bit quicker now. So if you have two inputs, but we have one cross path here. So whenever we have cross paths, we've got to go think about the output permutation to be able to switch the outputs. We have these two, we've got this out, this output of this, input of that. And the way that we can do this is to vertically merge them. So what we do, first of all, we've got to vertically, first, the first thing that we've got to do is vertical merging. So vertical merging of these two, as you see, vertical merging. I don't go through that because it takes my time, but if I show them in this film, I think it would be better and more understandable. So I vertically out, actually merge them, and then do the permutation, output permutation, to be able to get rid of that cross. And then horizontal merging. As you see, we have the horizontal merging. As we see the same thing that we get here, this is the topological expression, but I think these graphs are easier. The network design define NE, N21, N12, all of them should be defined, find the horizontal merging, sorry, vertical merging by them, and then output permutation, and output permutation inverse of that, and to be able to find the original one, and derive N11 from N121 and N21 if possible. The network design, we've got another algorithm to be able to actually design the network, define NE, N11, N12, and N22. Vertical merging of them, find the permutation, and inverse of that, inverse of this to find N11, N21, and derive N21 from N11 if you want to design that. I'll skip that because of interest of time. This is another way that actually we can find N22 and N12. The other one is when we have single local feedback, one node. So let me see if I can move that. Yes, so now we've got the feedback here. What we do, as I said, because as you see, we have a feedback, this comes there, it's a loop here. We've got to get rid of that. But how? First of all, we put it here, this F11 as a node. And then, you know, and as you see, it goes back to this one, from F1 to N1. This one goes to this one, and this is V11 here. So first of all, we put them, make structure it as a network. And then what we do, first of all, you've got to vertically merge them. Vertical merging is first thing, and then horizontal merge. First vertical, and then horizontal. Vertical and horizontal. When you do that, you've got to get rid of that loop. If you remember, I explained that using equivalent feedback, you can do that. All the operations I explained, so you can use them and get this. As you see, this is the equivalent of this very complex structure that we could actually convert into a single modular base that you can use it now for modeling. So yes, this is the last one, and this is F11 is the feedback node, and this is the final notation of the actually NE. If you wanted to drive F11, for example, you've got to define NE and N11 and N12, and you've got to confirm that NE satisfies the feedback constraint. If possible, make NE equal to this one, then you've got to make the matrices equal and actually drive F1 from the equation that you have here. Network with multiple local feedback. Now, if we have multiple local, as you see here, something like that. So how we can actually do the operations and actually do all of these vertical, horizontal, merging, equivalent, everything actually to be able to make a single equivalent Boolean matrix for the this network. First of all, we need F1 as a node, as you see, as a node here. It goes there. We've got, as you see, N11, the output is V1, it goes to the F11. So we need a node for F11 because this input, this output goes there, as you see here. Then this input goes to N11 as well. Sorry, W12. So we need that. So as you see here, this goes there. F2 goes there. But we don't have some nodes here. As you see, N1 here, N12 here. F12 should go there because that fits there. This one fits this one. But in terms of the network, we don't have these nodes in the network operation, fuzzy network operation. We need to have all the nodes. If you don't have that nodes, we use identity nodes. They are the identity matrices. It means that the main diagonal is one in terms of the dimension that you have. They don't change the operation, but in terms of the mechanical operation that help you to make that single equivalent linguistic composition. So in that case, we've got N11, N12, I are added here. How to actually work it out. The first thing is to, as I said, vertically merge them. You vertically merge them. These three together, these together, these two together. If you do them. And then what you've got to do get is actually cross by output permutation. You get rid of that. So now everything is ready. Merge them horizontally. Merge these three horizontally. When you do that, merge them horizontally, you've got to get rid of this. How? By equivalent feedback. Equivalent feedback. As you see, you have two of them. You have two inputs as equivalent feedback. So this is the equivalent one matrix, that one falsification, inference and defalsification for this one, which is very complex for this one. So as you see, all of those simple operations can help you. For network design, again, go backward, find NE, N11, N12, I, and F1 of 2, F12, you've got to do all the operation in the reverse to be able to find, for example, F11. This is another type of that in different ways, actually in the opposite direction, you can actually find and design your network. Now we've got network with single global feedback. One set of at least two adjacent nodes embraced by feedback, if you have something like this. So I think it's quite a sensible thing. So you've got that node, you've got to put it here. If you put it here, you need to have something here. So I use identity node. If you have identity node here, you've got to vertically merge them, these two first, and horizontally merge these three. So these two together, horizontally merge with these two. And when you do that, get rid of that loop. Get rid of that loop. If you get rid of that loop, you get there. So N1, N12, I13, vertically merge with this one. And then you've got to get rid of that feedback. And this is the algorithm for network design. Define NE, N11, N12, I13, and F12. Make sure that NE satisfies actually the feedback constraint. You've got to make these two equivalent. When you make that equivalent, you can go and find this one. By horizontal merging and drive that from that. I do actually refer you to the Alex's book because you can actually find all of the, I'll tell you which book is it and you can use that. With this one, network design, this is at least two set of the nodes embraced by separate feedback with at least two adjacent nodes in each set. As you see, if you have something like that. So what we've got to do, first of all, make a node for that. It goes there, somewhere here. Yep, and we've got this one goes there. As you see, we've got to have some nodes there. The places that we don't have identity nodes, we've got to create some identity node. They don't influence the design. They just help us for that actual operations. And when you do that, you've got to vertically merge them. Vertically merge these two vertically. You've got that and vertically merge these two together. As you see, horizontally merging these three together and get rid of this loop. I hope that's clear. So again, this goes there, this goes there, as you see these two here, we've got to create that one and vertically merge them and then horizontally and get rid of these two loops with the operations that I told you. The same story that we have, I don't actually go over that, but in the same way, you can actually go and find F12 and F11 in the opposite direction, try to actually find them by making them the matrices equivalent to find them. So over these 53 minutes, I explain you how the fuzzy network works, but we've got to evaluate the fuzzy network. A couple of things are quite important. Structural evaluation or evaluation of the fuzzy network, structural evaluation, matrices, number of the non-identity, identity nodes, those nodes that we created to be able to do the operations. So number of non-identity nodes, number of the non-identity network connections. When you have identity nodes, You have identity connection as well. So number of them are important. Overall cell, how many cells do we have there? That's important in terms of the evaluation. Number of the average path length for the first layer of the nodes and the average depths from the first level nodes to the last level. Those, all of those then in terms of structure is important in terms of evaluation of that. Are they good or bad? Linguistic evaluation. If you want to linguistically evaluate that, we have two, we have node composition equation, which is the vertically merge all of the nodes that you have and horizontally actually node, first of all, vertically merge them and then horizontally merge them to make only one single rule base equivalent. Composition hierarchical into a standard fuzzy system, decomposition of a standard into hierarchical fuzzy system. So this is the single node of a deep fuzzy network with all inputs. So data collection in terms of the data that you've got to actually use. Get details of the external inputs. This is the something that we need to know. Starting with node 1-1, get output destination from the node. See where the which nodes you've got to fit from that. Common inputs, store positions of the destination nodes, and if it's a unique input or common input, get other required nodes in terms of actually you've got to create your network based on that, and then make sure that all the inputs in terms of the where they go and where they go out of that, first of all, you've got to make that data collection before node composition. Data collection and structure of the network is quite important. Data processing before node composition. So what you've got to do, output merge two node position from the common input array, and update all the cell with the merged node data. So you've got to, when you have common input, you've got to merge them, vertically merge nodes in the same column in the network. As I said, vertical merging is quite important. Update, then each time you've got to update the cell array in terms of the matrix, the Boolean matrices that you have, then horizontally merge them and update it in this way. So first of all, you've got to actually store all the arrays in terms of when you merge them vertically and horizontally and make it ready for actually node composition. Node decomposition algorithm. So in the opposite way, if you want to actually decompose that, so find N11 from the first two inputs and the outputs. If x equal 2, go to step 9, which is the end, but it means that if you have actually it's only 2, and then you increase k, you actually put k, and you go and run this one, which is let me see, find nek from the first k inputs and the output, derive n11 from it. Means that you actually, we've got to go back and try to decompose them in terms of the we explained how actually you can decompose different nodes and to be able to make them. Functional evaluation matrices. So we have four indicators for the fuzzy network, which is quite important. We want to see, I'll explain everything and we want to see, okay, how it works. So we've got to have some indicators for that. We have four indicators. One of them is feasibility. Feasibility of the network is about it talks about linearity of that and how we can make it. If it is more feasible, the value of the feasibility indicator would go down. How we can do that? The number of the non-identity node, number of the inputs to the nth non-identity node. If you have pi and n, if you add all of them in terms of the non-identity nodes that you have, you come up with the value of fi. If fi is, when fi is lower, it means that it's better, it's more feasible. So This is one indicator for feasibility. In terms of the accuracy, so very common thing in the modeling, you've got to see the difference between the input and output. So you've got to add all the inputs, you've got all the non-identity and identity, but you've got to see the difference between the simulated and the measured discrete values for the model of the last layer. And you've got to find the average of that number of the discrete values. So it's something like a mean absolute value, but you've got to add them over all the nodes that you have and find this value. So the accuracy, which is very important, always better accuracy, lower AI value. Feasibility, if it's low, it's good. Accuracy, if it's low, it's good. The next one is efficiency in terms of the number of the operations that should be done. Number of the non-identity nodes, number of the outputs from the ith non-identity nodes with associated input-output mapping, and number of the rules. Rules are quite important here in terms of the operations that we want. Again, lower AI, better efficiency. How we can do that? We add all the QIOM by that. These are the number of the rows, and these are the number of the outputs of each non-identity. Identity nodes are not that important. We stick to non-identity nodes. So you multiply the number of the rules that you have and multiply by the number of the outputs of them, and you can find the efficient value for EI for the whole network. So efficiency in terms of the operations that should be done, actually if you follow this formula, you can easily get the value for EI. And the next one is transparency and about structure of the network. So P is over number of inputs, number of the outputs, and number of non-identity nodes again. If you come up with the lower TI, it means that it's more transparent, the structure is better, and you get a better model in terms of the interpretability. It's more interpretable, and it's white box, it's better. So lower value is better. Two case studies. We've got three inputs, copper concentration, iron concentration, and debit of the or pulp. So, and this is the Y value. We've got actually a number of linguistic variables for variable one, variable two, variable three, and the output. If we merge them, if you've got three nodes, if you merge them and actually run the model, we come up with the value for fuzzy network. What we can use all the inputs in terms of the single fuzzy system, compare it with the hierarchical, do multiple FIC, and do one for fuzzy network, and we want to compare them. This is the value that we get for fuzzy standard fuzzy system. All the inputs go into actually three inputs, one output, all of them node, and we get the fuzzification, inference and defuzzification, and actually find the values. This is the values, as you see, this is model value, and this is data values, and you can see the differences. Here you can see the differences, for example, here. This is for the hierarchical fuzzy system, if you do the modeling, and this is for the network. Fuzzy network. If you create a fuzzy network and then use hierarchical, but combine them using the techniques that I told you and do the modeling, you will get that. This is important. This is what we see. Feasibility, those indicators, accuracy, efficient, transparency, all of them have been calculated here. Fuzzy system, hierarchical, and fuzzy network. In terms of feasibility, these two are similar. As you see, feasibility, fuzzy network superior to standard fuzzy system, but equivalent to that. In terms of feasibility, as you see, it's better to use fuzzy network hierarchical. In terms of the accuracy, fuzzy inferior to fuzzy standard fuzzy, but superior to hierarchical fuzzy system. So fuzzy network is between these two variables, which we expected. We know that that's the best in terms of accuracy because you do only one fuzzification, inference and defuzzification. Here you do multiple because of the error term goes up. But this is a hybrid between these two. So we expected to get such a value. Efficiency, fuzzy network equivalent to standard fuzzy system inferior to this one. In terms of efficiency, actually it wasn't as good as hierarchical, but equivalent to this one. And transparency, obviously this is the best model in terms of the transparency because it's more transparent and it's better superior to all of them. The other one, cases are two, retail pricing, expected X1, expected selling price for retail product, X2, difference between selling price and the cost of retail, X3, expected percentage of the sold, and this is the Y. The same story happens here. We've got number, we've got the simple linguistic variables, and these are the membership functions. And don't forget, FuzzY system works only for MamDani systems, not Zujaino, not any other FuzzY type 2, FuzzY type 2, and no. Only for MamDani FuzzY system. If we run this model, this is the output for FuzzY system, for standard FuzzY system. Again, you can see the black, you can see the difference between model and observation. And this is for hierarchical FuzzY system, and this is for FuzzY network. Again, comparison, as you see, feasibility, these two are similar. In terms of the accuracy, again, FuzzY network is between these two. In terms of the efficiency, this is hierarchical is the best. These two are similar. And in terms of the transparency. So in terms of the FuzzY network, you want to evaluate that. That's really good for modeling in terms of the transparency. And in terms of the accuracy, is quite, we can compensate the accuracy of that with the transparency. And we want to know more about the data, how it goes, not only about accuracy. So FuzzY network is quite promising approach. Composition of the hierarchical into standard FuzzY system, full preservation of a model feasibility, maximal improvement of the model accuracy, fixed loss of model efficiency, and full preservation of the model transparency. These are good stuff about that. The composition of that standard into hierarchical FuzzY system is no chain of model feasibility, minimal loss of model accuracy, fixed improvement of model efficiency, and no chain to of model transparency. So I explained everything about that, but just a little bit more about how this operation can be done. Alec, one of Alex's Erasmus exchange students, actually did loads of actually work on the MATLAB environment to write a code for all these operations in terms of how to merge them. All the M5s, MATLAB files are available on the math work on the MATLAB website, so you can find M5s for that if you just Google it, and you can find all of them. And word files with illustration examples are available there as well. Conclusion: theoretical significance of the FuzzY network, novel approved application of the discrete mathematics and control theory, detailed validation by benchmark example and case studies, methodological impact of the FuzzY network, extension of the standard and hierarchical FuzzY system, bridge between the standard and hierarchical FuzzY system. It's a hybrid approach, novel framework by for different types of rule-based system. Applications, modeling and simulation in the mining industry, in the retail industry, and I did one actually study, biggest study on the transport on telecommuting, and we got fantastic results for using FuzzY networks. As you see, different applications that can be done in different from finance to business, environment, navigation, and so many other variables. We have a complex system, we want to model FuzzY network, can be a promising approach if we can actually use FuzzY logic in that. References, Alex's book that I referred a couple of times here, Alex has got two books for that, and use of and the big data has been discussed by Handu and Gekov and other colleagues. And this is the work that I said in terms of the study that I did in terms of using rule-based networking transportation. Thank you very much. I hope that you enjoyed that. And if you have any questions, you are available to answer that. Thank you.